Anyway, the road to a victorious life. Last week we talked about grace. I hope you embrace it. Hope you fully understand it's by God's grace that we are who we are and how we are and what we get to enjoy and experience. It's all through His grace. It's His loving grace that we all get cell phones and they get to go off during church. Aren't we blessed? I'm thankful I'm born in the United States of America. I don't know what the future holds. I don't know exactly what's going to transpire. I've not been all around the world, but everything I see anywhere else, I'm thankful by God's grace I was born here. I'm thankful I was born in a country where I could hear the gospel. I'm thankful for people who shared the gospel with me, and I was able to get saved, and God has seen fit to allow me to serve Him and to follow Him. But I want to ask this question. What is the victorious life for you? If I was to ask you what would bring victory in your life, what is success? What is me getting to the place where I know I have succeeded? What's victory? What's the victorious life? See, in Scripture, it's totally different than what most of us make it out to be. You know, bigger homes, bigger cars, you know, more toys, a lot of money in the bank. I've arrived. I'm successful. I can take my ease. John, describing victory, 1 John 5:4 puts it this way, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world." And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith in Christ, and that salvation is victory. The word overcometh is interesting to me. The word to conquer also is in that, but the Greek word translated overcomer literally means victor, or the verb is nikeo, and the noun form is Nike. Now, I did a youth camp years and years ago when they deemed me young enough to be part of youth, and I had designed some t-shirts, and they said Hyper Nike. And on the swoosh, I put a cross over the thing. I thought they looked nice, and people reminded me that Nike got that from the goddess of victorious whatever. And I had to remind them I got that from Scripture. I can't help it if they messed it up. I just took mine from how Paul did it. Because when he says we're more than conquerors, it's actually Hyper Nike. And, you know, well, you're taking, no, I can't help what the world has done. It was identifiable with Nike, and I did steal part of their swoosh. But Scripture says, nay, in all these things I'm more than conquerors through Him that loved us. That I can attain Hyper Nike, if you would. I am victorious. I'm able to succeed by His grace in my life for His glory. But what does that look like? What does the road to victory look like for us? See, let me kind of lay it out, and then we're going to look at the life of Jesus and His victorious life. Tonight, at 6, we're going to look at Paul and his victorious life. But this morning, the road starts with humility. See, in the world, humility is not a good starting point for victory. You gotta get riled up. You got to get confident in yourself. You have to have some pride in order to succeed. The road continues with obedience and self-denial. Well, I don't know about you. If victory has to do with self-denial, I don't like it. Right? Victory is how many things can I conquer, not how many things can I give up. But if we look at this, the road is treacherous. You must be willing to lay down your life. Now, I thought we were going to talk about being victorious. What do you mean I may have to die? That doesn't sound like very much victory. Well, it's really determined by what you deem victory. The road also ends in victory if we understand what true victory is. Scriptures tell us it's a bad thing for the gain, the joys, the pleasures, the things of this world, and to lose your own soul. See, too many of us see victory as God kind of coming in and giving us what we want and helping us succeed in life. God's kind of become a life coach, you know. He just comes along, looks at your abilities, analyze where you want to go, and say, hey, we can get you somewhere better. And God says, I want to change where you want to go. I want you to go down a different path. I want you to do different things. I have a goal, and I want you to join mine. But all of us, we just kind of, hey, God, I want you to join me, right? I like it when God joins me, don't you? I like it when I pray, and God, this is what I want to do. This is what I'd like to see. This is what I want to accomplish. And God goes, woo, and I get to go to church and go, ooh, look at what God blessed me with, right? I like that. But that's not really the road to victory. Go to Philippians chapter 2 with me this morning. Philippians chapter 2. What was a victorious life? How can I know when I die I have lived the victorious life? Starting in chapter 2 of Philippians in verse 5, it says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So it's a mind change, right? I mean, if you get a coach and the coach is trying to help you say run and you have some bad habits in your running, he wants to help change your behavior and your mind so that you can be a better runner, right? Stop doing this. Start doing that. Breathe properly. And so he wants to change. And see, so many times our mind is set on what a victorious life is, and we're setting out to accomplish it, but we don't really know what God wants. How God designed. Because God wants to work in your life this morning. Y'all understand that? God really wants to work in our lives. God wants to move in a powerful way and do things in and through us. But it can't be for us. It has to be for God. Look at verse 6 as we go through this. Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, simply because he was God. Philippians 7. But made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Now, let's just put this in context before we go any further. Jesus is what? God. Y'all understand? He is the highest pinnacle, right? He is King of Kings, Lord of Lords. He's God. And he chose to put on humility and to humble himself and come into this world to die for our sins. To serve. Doesn't it just smack your pride in the face? God's willing to come off his throne for us. We're sitting there, I ain't doing that. Y'all don't know who I am. I've had people say that. Well, that ain't mine. All of us are called to serve. All of us are called to have a humble spirit. Being found in a fashion of a man, humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God has also highly exalted him, given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I want us to see this journey, if you would, this morning. I want us all to understand, by God's grace, we can live a victorious life. One that when we finish our course on this world, which, by the way, we don't know when that ends. Sort of like running a marathon. You're just like, Lord, where's the finish line? Yeah, we don't know when our journey ends, right? Some of us are running 5Ks. Some of us are running, you know, a 10K. Some of us have a life of a half marathon. Some of us have a life of a full marathon. Some of us are doing those mega things they do now where it's, you know, 70-some miles and some stupidity of life. But you don't know how long your race is, right? So you got to be ready to finish it at a moment's notice. Today, God could go, your race is over. And guess what? You can't go tomorrow. I'm going to get my act together. Because you just got today. Jesus' birth was a birth of humility. The scripture we just read, made himself of no reputation and took upon the form of a servant. Again, let me encourage us to look at our lives. God does not want us to be prideful people. But we are. We like to make statements by what we wear, by what we drive, by where we live, how we work. We're people, we don't use the word pride, but we use the word very confident. Very confident. But in order to have a life of victory, we got to find a place to humble ourselves and find the Lord. I think it's interesting, Jesus Christ came and took on human form so that we can find, through humility, a new birth in the godly form. I just think that's fascinating that Jesus took on earthly form so us, humans, could repent and receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and take on heavenly forms. Let me encourage you. I don't know if it's going to come to the Washington area or not, but the movie, The Case for Jesus, for Christ, it was weird. We went and saw it last night, and as we're walking down the thing, they just put one word on the you know, rooms where you go in. On the right was the ghost. On the left was Christ. And then if you went a little further, there was heresy called the shack. And I was just like, man, what a weird thing to go down here. I make a left towards Christ. But you got your choices. It's a good movie. I hope you'll see it. And when it gets out on video even, it's a good movie of him struggling to come to the place and realization that Jesus Christ is Lord. Have you ever done that? Have you ever really, truly got to the place where you humbled, surrendered yourself and said, God, I need what you did on the cross to pay the penalty for my sins? I'm not saying you went through a religious practice. I'm not saying you went through some phase of religiousness to get there. I'm not saying you prayed a prayer, but do you know you got to a place where you fully humbled yourself before the true and living God and accepted him as your Lord and as your Savior. Do you know today, if you were to die, you're going to spend eternity in heaven? I'm not asking you if your mom or preacher told you that you are going to spend eternity in heaven. I'm asking if you, in your spirit, in your soul, in your understanding of who God is, do you know that you surrendered yourself before God and received him as Lord and Savior? Because then he makes you a godly new creation. Old things passed away, behold, all things become new. See, some people think they're closer to God because they took communion this morning and don't realize if you're saved, if you're born again, if you're a child of God, you are made righteous. But you got to humble yourself. You got to surrender. You got to repent. You got to give up. You got to turn over everything for God to work. See, the victorious road starts with a road of humility. But then it's surrender and obedience. Jesus didn't just come and live on this earth and then built him a nice big old house and went fishing. Jesus didn't just say, well, I'm going to get married and have kids and, you know, and that's it. I'm going to have all this stuff and I'm going to leave it to my kids. See, here's the thing with the victorious life for a Christian, for one who is truly born again, it is being surrendered and obedient to God. We're on this Palm Sunday, Jesus' victorious entry into Jerusalem, and he comes in and everyone is celebrating. But then throughout the week, Jesus is forsaken, betrayed, beaten, and crucified. He's at a place where he asked the Lord to let this cup pass from me. But what does he say? Nevertheless, not my will, but God. See, here's the thing. This is the other question I need to ask you. Not only have you surrendered to receive Jesus as your Savior, but have you surrendered to live your life as Jesus, as your Lord? See, it says in verse 8, being found in the fashion of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient. We must be willing to give up everything for God's will and God's glory. That's the victorious life. Everything. Everything you got. Everything you dream to be. Every desire you want to go down needs to be surrendered before God. That's the victorious life. You know why most Christians are frustrated in their Christian walk? They think once they get saved, God's just going to line their pockets with cash. And don't realize that it's about surrendering. See, the name it claim it only works in the United States of America, by the way. It's trying to make roots in Ghana, but it's hard to name and claim. Because even now there's preachers that will ask when we're over there, shouldn't a preacher have good, nice things so everyone sees God is blessing and desires to have what he has? You're missing the whole gospel. See, we got a whole lot of people following the blessings, but not the blesser. Is it all surrendered? Maybe God wants you to give up all you have. Follow him. I don't know about you. If my life is just a 10K and it ends tomorrow, I like to say I've been on the road of victory in Christ. And the only way to get there is for me to say, God, not my will, but yours. God, what do you want to do? Because see, God wants to do in your life. Now, I'm telling you, it's not always been easy. It's not always been where I am, but I'm telling you, for the most part, when I am, God has blessed over and above that which I need. He has taken care of. And I'm telling you, some of y'all are struggling to get where you want to go. And it may not be where God wants you to be. If you'll turn it over, God can at least make a clear path for you and say, let's do something different. But you got to surrender. That's Jesus' life before the Heavenly Father. But then you got to be willing to lay down. Jesus' willingness to lay down his life for others. Jesus was willing to sacrifice for others. See, the road of victory not only is one of humility in before God, because that's easy. Be honest, if you know who God is, to humble yourself before God and say, God, whatever you want, that should really be easy. It's not amazing that we love God, right? That's what Scripture says. It's amazing that God loves us. I mean, to say, God, we love you, that's just should be norm. But then to go further and say, I'm here to serve others. Okay, God, I'm willing to surrender, but I got to beat out so-and-so, right? I have a better life than him, but I don't like him, right? Sort of like Thanksgiving. If you don't see your family for a long time, everybody's got to somehow carve out how their life is better than everyone else's life. You know, this is where I made it. What are you doing? It's difficult. He says this, and being found in the fashion of a man, he humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. What did it cost Jesus to serve others? His whole life. His whole life. I'm thankful for our church. Thankful there was 25 people or so that came out yesterday, and we worked in a few people's homes and helped cleaned up their yards and just tried to share the love of God with them and to invite them out and to just encourage some people who probably didn't have anyone to help. And it's kind of cool, but you know what is really hard? It was the best Saturday of the year. Because it's hard to say, God, my weeds are high. Right? I'm going to go weed someone else's place. It's hard. God showed this to me. I hadn't been in the ministry very long, bought my first computer, and I was just excited. I was taking it out of the box, and this elderly man at the church calls, because we were holding his money and helping him out. Pastor Joe, I want to go to supper. I'm like, I literally just got it home. Bought it at Montgomery Ward's, y'all. Anyway, just got it home. Just pulled it out of the box, set it down, opened the manual. Because I want to go to dinner. I'm like, God, can't I just say I'm busy? And it was just God going, are you here for people? So I took him to dinner. Man, he couldn't have weighed 80 pounds. So we're eating dinner. He gets done. And he looks at me. I think I'll have another burger and fries. I'm like, because I'm like, take out? Anyway, so we sat there. And see, here's the thing that you got to ask yourself. Is your life really become all about you? I like what Kyle Eiderman said. When we say yes to following Jesus, we are agreeing to carrying a cross, and that will be painful at times. Are we just willing to say, God, I'll go the extra mile for you? I'll go the extra mile for someone else. The victorious road. Jesus' road ended in victory for all who will believe. Amazing scripture. Because we try to identify with the world so often, right? We gotta act like the world, dress like the world, behave like the world, so that the world doesn't think we're strange and come. And Jesus says that the world will be won by the love that we have for one another. That they'll look into the church and see the church people out interacting in the world, and they have this love for each other, and they go, what is up with them? They help each other. They give to each other. They encourage each other. They strengthen each other. They even get upset at each other and try to correct each other. What are those people? See, I really think we got the gospel wrong. Because we act like them, behave like them, and carry them and say, would you pray this prayer? And they go, I'm just like you. Without a prayed prayer. I don't have to live a hypocritical life. You do. Right? I remember a friend of mine one time, he was backslidden, he was out of church, he didn't care for God, and we were talking over at the hospital where I was working, we were talking, he said, oh man, so embarrassed the other night. I went into the bar that I usually go into, and I saw one of the deacons from the church at the other end of the bar, and I ducked, because I was embarrassed. And then as I ducked, I went, wait a minute, it's okay for me to be here. What's he doing here? Because it wasn't even a very appropriate bar. Anyway, and he's like, and see, the world that we're trying to win doesn't want people like them. They want people like Christ. Look, Philippians 2:9. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him, given him a name which is above every name. I'm telling you, if you live a victorious life for Christ and humble yourself before God, God in due season will lift you up. Victory starts when you allow God to conquer you. Conquer you. I am the biggest problem of my walk for God. I could put a whole lot of what ifs in there. Well, if I grew up in a more wealthy home with better Christian parents who did da-di-da-di-da-di-da. Boy, if I pastored a church that just loved me a little more, I'd be a better pastor. Right? It's just whatever. I mean, every pastor should have season green seat tickets, and this church doesn't get them for me. Because I win a lot of people in that area, I guarantee it. Brother, every week I'd get someone in a chokehold. You're coming to Jesus because I got to keep these seats. You know what I'm saying? It's you know, we got to have excuses. But here's the biggest one. I am the problem of me. And if I'll surrender to God and allow him to work and move in my life and allow the other things to become peripheral and little and God to be the centric thing in my life, I would be able to live a life better. Because Mark puts it this way, and when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Jesus, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. He goes on trying to fill his church, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake and the gospel, the same shall save it. Huh. Jesus has not read any church health books to tell people to give up. Is not the way to build a church. You must promise them everything. For whosoever exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. See, victory happens when you understand that the life you are called to. What life are you called to? See, Jesus understood he had a purpose in life. And what was that purpose? To die on the cross for our sins. To be victorious. What's your purpose? What is your purpose? Is to live a life for Christ and be willing to die for him. See, you are a child of the living God, and your enemy is Satan, sin, and the selfishness of the flesh. But I want it. Parents, isn't that the biggest problem in your home?
I want it. I want.
It's like, suck it up. Kids won't stay around if you don't give them everything. Revelation puts it this way. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Talking about the things of the world and answer of Christ. And by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto death. Read the book of Revelation. A beautiful picture of the saints who were martyred. And they're in glory celebrating what God's going to do. So my question, in all the battles that are going on, are you willing to surrender to the journey? See, God wants to do something amazing in your life. And the journey that you're on is not going to bring victorious life unless you surrender it to him. I want you to watch this testimony of Chris Carpenter coming to the Lord through Wainwright, who spent year after year trying to get him to renew his faith in the Lord. Play that if you would.
Other teams couldn't stand him because he just wanted to beat him more than they wanted to beat him.
He's the guy that you hit a home run on and you keep your head down and you run around the bases real fast and because you know he's looking at you.
You're starting pitcher, that whole day is revolved around you. So from the time you wake up to the time you take the mound is so many different kinds of emotions. I grew up in a Christian family going to church, and as I got into professional baseball, I lost that. It was about money, it was about cars, it was about the fame. I was never happy. No matter what I did, it led to the end, alcohol. I was lost. There was times where I didn't even care about myself or anybody else. So it really, the situation dictated who I was. Then all the guilt and shame and all that stuff started coming into play. Every day I woke up and I was like, oh man, what did I do that for last night? Or why did I act that way? Or why did I talk that way to somebody? Or it's like, that's not who you are. And I just continued to spiral down to beating myself down every single day.
I said, I'm going to pick a guy, somebody who's established, somebody who's working harder than everybody else, somebody who's doing things seemingly the right way, and I'm just going to be a shadow. And it didn't take me more than one day to find out who I wanted to shadow, and it was Chris Carper.
He was the perfect young rookie. He was a sponge to everything that anybody had to say.
He commanded respect because of the ferocious way that he attacked his work. I couldn't respect that more.
I know Adam had invited him to chapel a lot, and I think he was always a little resistant.
And I always asked him, and he's not against it. He wasn't against it. He would always say, no thanks, buddy, but say a prayer for me. And I did, you know, a lot.
Every Sunday, hey, Carp, we're going to chapel. I'm good. Carp, we're going to chapel. I'm good. And one year I came in, and I had this Bible, brown leather Bible with my name inscribed in it. And I looked at it, and I picked it up, and there's a note in it from Adam.
Or a little note on the inside or whatever, and I just, I again said, hey, just whenever you, you know, if you ever need something to read.
He invited me a couple times, and, you know, in the back of my mind, I was like, I got other things to do, you know? But for some reason, this year, I said yes.
A lot of times when these guys come into town, they think they're coming to a fun dinner. We're gonna, you know, have some drinks, and we're gonna play golf the next day, and it's gonna be great. And we play golf, and we have dinner, but we listen to someone who really drives the gospel home. You know, a good message. And a lot of the players that have come in and gone to that banquet, they left convicted. Almost the like, I've got to get out of here and do something rebellious to sort of counterbalance this holiness that I just heard. And I think that's what happened to him.
One of the nights ended, and I ended up going out with a couple other guys that were there, and I just put myself in a situation that I, again, didn't need to be in. I was in the middle of nowhere, an hour and a half away from where I was supposed to be. My phone was dead, and I had no way to get home. I didn't know where I was, what I was doing. Every time I called someone, my phone went dead. I kept calling the cab company over and over and over again. My phone kept going dead. I was struggling at home. I was coming to the end of my career. I was struggling with alcohol. I was struggling in everything. And literally raised my hands into the sky and asked God for help. I said, I don't know how you can do this, but I need to get home and I need to be saved. 15 minutes later, a cab showed up. It was a man and his wife and their dog. I rode home with the dog in the back seat, and they dropped me off. It was light by the time we got back. He's like, how'd you get out here? I was like, I don't know. He brought me back, dropped me off at the place. I packed my bag and got in the car and went to the airport. Anybody that doubts that there is a God, I know I can't anymore.
I felt like he was going to be the last guy to do that. You know, he was too tough for that.
Just really impactful on my life, encouraging to see what Jesus and the Holy Spirit had done to Chris Carpenter, and what an encouragement he can be to other guys.
Without a doubt, I knew in 5 seconds that this was real.
I want to love how he loves me, and how he took care of me, and how he saved me. Man, he is everything to me, is what he is.
Stand with me if you would. Heads bowed, attitude of prayer. Just want to ask, what journey are you on? If it's not a journey with Christ, it's going to destruct and destroy you. It may be fun along the way. You may think it's victorious. But God desires to work in you this morning. and give you a victorious life. But you gotta surrender. Not just to salvation, but to the life. And willing to live for Christ, even in an environment where others don't understand. Father, I pray right now that each and every one of us would search our hearts to see if we're in the faith or not, to see if we're surrendered to what you want to do and how you desire to work. Move, Father. Bring us to you. Get us on that road that leads to victory in and through you. We pray this in Jesus' name.